Hello there, I'm Rick Parfitt. Welcome to Electrifying, the history of the electric guitar in five easy pieces.
Deep down in Louisiana, close to New Orleans, way back up in the woods among the evergreens, there stood a log cabin made of earth and wood, where lived a country boy named Johnny B. Good, who never ever learned to read or write so well, but he could play a guitar just like a ring in a bell. Go, go!
We start in the 50s, looking at the decade that brought us Muddy Waters, Buddy Holly, B.B. King, Chuck Berry and Duane Eddy, to name but a few of the fine guitarists we'll be hearing from. And the 50s really did kick off with a bang. In 1950, Leo Fender introduced the Fender Broadcaster, sometimes referred to as the plank guitar because it was literally a solid plank of wood. In 1951, it was renamed the Fender Telecaster and became the first really successful solid-bodied guitar. And I've been playing tellies for 30 years, and I can't complain. But Fender weren't to have things all their own way. Their arch rivals Gibson had a secret weapon, a certain Mr. Lester Polfus, and in 1952, they introduced their Les Paul model. How much work Les actually did for Gibson isn't quite clear, but there's no doubt that Lester, or Les, player, inventor, and engineer, was an all-round guitar genius.
Les Paul was really significant in inventing the electric guitar. I mean, he was perhaps too far ahead of everybody else for his own good. But more than that, it was a whole kind of aesthetic. Les Paul invented multi-track recording. He almost invented the modern recording industry, where you don't just replicate what you play live. Les Paul as a guitarist was fairly influential. He played with people like Bing Crosby, and Bing paid for him to open up a studio. But it was more just as a trailblazer, somebody championing the new instrument, that he really had his effect.
Paul Trinker, editor of Mojo Music magazine and a guitar writer who certainly knows his Fenders from his Gibsons. And here is Les Paul with the full Monty of his special effects on the 1951 recording of Whispering. Just about every guitarist over the last 50 years, Les Paul was influenced by the legendary Django Reinhardt. Despite losing two fingers from his left hand in a fire, Reinhardt, playing with jazz violin giant Stefan Grappelli, built a massive reputation. When Stefan and Django came to Britain, Bert Whedon, one of our top guitarists of the 50s, had the unenviable task of sitting in alongside the great Django.
It's never wise for a guitar player to copy another one, and I never have done. When I was with Django Reinhardt, I wouldn't play like him. I wanted to play like myself. And Stefan Grappelli said, "Bert, you play like Bert Whedon. Don't try and be a second-hand Django Reinhardt."
Bert went on to play on hundreds of British rock and roll records as a session guitarist, have hits in his own right with instrumentals like Guitar Boogie Shuffle, and still found time to write his guitar tutor, Play in a Day. It seems that every budding guitarist had a copy, and it gained Bert a fan club that includes Eric Clapton, Jeff Beck, George Harrison and Brian May, not to mention yours truly. Not a bad lineup, eh? While in the early 50s, Bert's electric guitar would have been a rarity in Britain, in America, the instrument was already well established in the music of the blues. And one of the pioneers of electric blues playing was Muddy Waters. And here he is on Rollin' and Tumblin', Part 1 from 1950.
Morning. Muddy was the guy who had the first electric record. He made a record with just him and a drummer in, I think, about 1948. And that revolutionised the whole music industry in America. Suddenly there was this new sound. It reflected a new kind of urban experience. People like Muddy had moved down from the country up to cities like Chicago. And the pace of life was much faster, it was much harder, it was much louder. Muddy's music exemplified that, and so did this new instrument, the electric guitar.
In 1955, Muddy Waters directed Chuck Berry and his song Ida Red to Leonard Chess, who along with his brother Phil ran Chess Records, the label of many Chicago blues musicians. Leonard liked the song but hated the title. Chuck changed it to Maybelline and lit the touch paper on rock and roll.
It's really easy to underestimate Chuck Berry's impact. Chuck Berry was a songwriter. He used the electric guitar. He almost invented the whole convention of rock and roll. And Chuck kept writing great records, bringing different rhythms. And really, you could say that the first few years of Chuck Berry's songwriting totally anticipated the first few years of the Beatles' songwriting. It maybe took the Beatles till 1965 to shake off Chuck Berry's influence.
Chuck was just beginning his assault on the charts. The blues boy, B.B. King, was already well established. A consummate guitarist and singer, King performed with a passion that was to make him the most influential blues guitar player of his generation. And at 74, his distinctive style is still packing them in. There's hope for us yet.
I've never been good at using chords as an accompaniment behind my singing. So I don't play proper chords, but when I sing, I hear myself playing. When I play, I hear myself singing. So I think it takes the two to make one. I couldn't play the bottleneck or the slide, so I trill my hand, and for some reason my ears would hear something similar, in my opinion, of the slide or the bottleneck. And I would do that every time I'd pick up the guitar, so now it's hard for me to keep from doing it.
There we go, 3 o'clock blues from B.B. King. But the guitar that was heard by most people in the 50s belonged to none of the blues masters. Wasn't played by Chuck Berry, and not even by Buddy Holly. It was the guitar of Scotty Moore. The band was the Blue Moon Boys, and the singer, Elvis Presley.
We had gone through several songs. Elvis seemed like he knew every song in the world, knew the lyrics. And so we were just sitting, somebody would mention a song, and we'd play it to the best of our ability, and Sam was mainly listening to his voice. And during a break, we was having a Coke, coffee, whatever. Elvis just picked up his guitar and just started frailing it in singing this song, That's All Right, Mama.
Well, that's all right, Mama.
And Bill picked up the bass and started slapping it. Just everybody just acting a fool, mainly, just cutting up. I joined in with them, and Sam heard it through the open door to the control room and came around and asked us, so what are you guys doing? And we told him, oh, just fooling around. And he said, well, fool around a little bit more. I said, it sounded pretty good. Let me get some of that on tape. And several would stop then and figured out, you know, what's a verse, what's a chorus, and I worked up a little turnaround for it in the middle, and then would go through it a few times, and Sam would work with him, well, closer to the mic on this word or back off on that, and a few takes later, we had it. We didn't know what we had, but we had it.